Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
It's great to see all of you this morning on a beautiful day. We're glad that you're here worshiping with us this morning. I'm fully recharged after my cruise to the Caribbean. Notice I'm still not tan and burnt in ways that I could not even explain, but I made it back. And just a couple of quick notes about the trip, because people have been asking me while I was away. It's a ship that holds 6,000 guests, but because of COVID restrictions, there were only 750 guests on the whole boat. I had a hot tub all to myself for the week, so that was a good thing. The other news is I married a nice Filipino girl that I, one of the staff. I still don't know what the bottom part of her face looks like, but she had kind eyes, I assumed. The rest followed, but it was wonderfully refreshing. But it did remind me of what it's like to be on a boat with, even that, there were still 2,000 staff, be on a boat with so many people and still have to struggle with feeling like you're alone. And I thought to myself, this meeting house is kind of like a boat. In fact, the early churches were actually built by taking old ships that were no longer in commission and turning them upside down, that the rudder would serve as the steeple. And it was also symbolic of God rescuing the world on the ark. And so I thought about how this is a similar kind of ship, but one where we all know and care about each other and understand that we're all on the same journey and that our hatches are open to anyone who comes through our doors to be welcomed in as family. And as our sign out front says, if you've come as a stranger, we hope you would leave as a friend today and take every opportunity to do that, especially if you're new today. Join us right through that door in the lounge where we have coffee hour, which won't only have hot coffee and some sweet snacks to take, but also warm fellowship to enjoy. And I'm always proud to say, if that's the first time you show up for a coffee hour, you will not be left standing by yourself awkwardly. So please join us. Let us know of your presence by filling out one of the cards that you'll find in the pews, and just place them in one of these beautiful yellow boxes so that they get placed on my desk shortly after service. And let me know how we can welcome you a little bit more. If you'd like to just remain anonymous sitting in the pews this morning to catch your spiritual breath, that's fine as well. You let us know when you want us to recognize that you've been here. And special welcome to those of you at home that are worshiping with us today. We're glad that you're here as well. And as is our most recent tradition, we're going to all stand up and wave and say good morning to our foreign guests. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
There we go. I have a sign in my office that somebody must have brought, Terry brought, because she heard me mention it 2 weeks ago before I was gone for the week, to make, if you'd like, a sign that you can hold up for the camera to welcome people. So we're going to have to talk to media to zoom out so that we can actually show people if they eventually start bringing signs for people at home. But we welcome you at home this morning with a little reminder. Today is a communion Sunday, so you'll need to get the elements that you are going to use at home this morning to participate with us. So take a second to do that quickly when you get a chance. Communion is early in the service. So that said, we're glad that you're here. We're looking forward to worship with energy, integrity, and as is our tradition, a little playful sense of humor. So let's take a moment now and center ourselves for a moment of quiet before worship. Now, before we open with our song called to worship, does anyone have an announcement to lift up this morning? There we go. You're only allowed to put up your right hand, Edie, not your left hand for announcements. Yeah, it didn't work.
Don't pick on me, I'm sensitive.
Yeah.
You should see the other guy.
Yeah.
As you remember, a couple weeks ago, I announced that our tag sale is coming up on the 6th and 7th of May, and we're going to need some help. We might need a little bit more help, because we have to get all the boxes off the stage. So if there's any strong women and strong gentlemen that are can give me an hour or two on Thursday just to unload the stage, we can do the rest of it. So if you want to see me at the coffee hour afterwards, I promise I won't hit you.
Thank you. And Edie was too embarrassed to tell you that the reason she's in an arm sling right now is because she came across someone who said a disparaging word about the Lady Huskies. That person is in a full body cast right now. I have to go visit him later today, so. Thank you, Edie. And this coming Wednesday is our last of the season, Lenten Soup Suppers. We've had some great gatherings, some great programs, and some magnificent soups. And each one is not tied to the other. So you're welcome to come on out this Wednesday at 6 p.m. for the last of them. It's a great time to get to know some people or to socialize with folks here on our little cruise through life. So please feel free to join us. Soup is served at 6 p.m. We're out the door by 8. So come on out and join us as well. Let's now gather our voices together in our song called to worship, sung responsibly and found in your bulletins.
Be seated. Please join me in the unison prayer of praise and confession that is printed in your bulletins. Touch our lips, O God, with joyous gratitude, that the words of our prayers may be acceptable to you. In this season of Lent, invade our hearts with a new reverence and responsiveness that even the silence may be filled with your messages. May these moments of worship bring us closer to you, that our lives will be enriched and strengthened in all we think, say, and do. Gracious God, we confess what seems always with us, broken things within us that seem never to mend, empty places within us that seem always to ache, things like buds within us that never flower. O God of love and grace, help us to accept ourselves. Lead us to do those good and true things that are not compromised by anything within or without. As much as can be, mend us, fill us, and make us bloom. Forgive our sinful and selfish ways as we quietly lay them before you. Please join me in a silent prayer of confession. Jesus knows our every weakness and loves us still. Awaken to the promise of Christ's amazing grace. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
We gather together.
We gather together at Christ's table this morning with an open invitation to all who wish to join us. We have no restrictions, only an invitation to partake with us this cup and this bread that we offer today. And we do so with the knowledge that in that moment and in that giving and receiving, that God is open to forgiving sins, to offering grace and love, and to help refresh and renew our lives each time we do so. So come, for all is ready and all are welcome. On the night of his betrayal, gathered together with his disciples, those who he loved most, Jesus took bread. And after breaking it, he gave it to the disciples and said, "This is my body broken for you for the forgiveness of sins." Ministering in his name, we offer you now this bread. Jesus said, take and eat. This is my body broken for you. In the same manner, after they had eaten, Jesus took the cup. And after giving thanks, he gave it to the disciples, saying, this cup is the new covenant of my blood shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Ministering in his name, we offer you now this cup.
Come to the table of grace.
Jesus said, "Take and drink, and do this as often as you do in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Gracious and Lord and God, we give you thanks for gathering us together at this table, where your grace and your love and your abundant forgiveness are made available to us. Send us out now into this new day, renewed, refreshed, and ready to do your work by your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And now that we have been refreshed at Christ's table, let us offer one another a sign of the peace. Peace be with you.
Coffee hour hasn't started yet. Come on. So just a few items quickly, worship related. This is, I think, if I'm correct, the first time since the pandemic hit that we've been able to now do communion the way we had done it 2 years ago. And though we've managed to serve communion, or when we were on lockdown, invite you via the internet to take communion at home, this brings us full circle. But I should have reminded you, especially for guests, that our tradition is to serve your neighbor, not to take your own communion in your hands, but to pass the plate to your neighbor, serve them. They're not leaving without lollipops, Gwen. You're not going to get away with it. Not going to happen. In fact, Val is going to stop them. Yeah. So just as a reminder to everyone, and isn't it wonderful to feel that we can now do this the way we've traditionally done it all those years? And also, last month when we did communion, I forgot to go down and to serve the deacons. And boy, did they let me know about that. So today I made sure, but I had no choice, because as each couple came on up, they reminded me not to forget to go down and serve them communion as well. So it'll take a little time to get back into practice. Bye-bye, kids. Enjoy the lollipops. Eat them before you start Sunday school. You get all that extra energy. Oh, and ice cream today. Ho, ho, ho! We better not run later. I'm going to be in big trouble. Kids bouncing off the walls. Just catching up where I am. There we are. Let's join together and remain seated in joining us in our next hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine, number 514 in your hymnals. The trade-off is you can sit, but use that extra energy to sing loud.
Our first scripture reading today comes from the book of Micah, chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Our gospel reading today comes from the book of John, chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. Mary anoints Jesus. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii? We could have given this money to the poor." He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She brought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." This is the word of the Lord.
So, what smells good to you these days? What smells good to you these days? I really want to know what it is that smells good to you. We all have different thoughts on that. So I'm going to give you a chance, if you want, to raise your hand. But because I'm mic'd and you're not, be sure to say it loudly or I'm going to have to repeat it. But I want to know, give me something that just smells great to you. Yes.
Beef stew.
Beef stew. There you go. Well, anything with beef before it smells good to me. Sure. Yes.
Chocolate.
Chocolate. Dark or light? I know the answer, by the way. Dark. Yes. Dark. Dark chocolate. Terry.
Coffee.
Coffee smells good to you. If you have a coffee maker that makes the coffee before you get up, it's better than an alarm. Yes!
Popcorn.
Popcorn. Yeah. In fact, you can put on weight just smelling the buttered popcorn. Yes!
The house after having the windows open all day.
Yes. Opening the, especially in the beginning of spring, right? When that air starts coming in. Yes, Bob?
Cinnamon buns.
Cinnamon buns. Oh, yeah. Yep, yep. Someone else. Yes.
Babies.
And especially babies' heads, the top of their heads, after they've been washed up and smell like Johnson's baby shampoo, right? Yep. Anyone else? Yes, Patrick.
Pancakes.
Any particular kind? Some people love the smell of chocolate chip pancakes, others blueberry. All right, fine. That's fine. I don't want to get you too deep. Yes, Lisa.
Clean laundry.
Clean laundry right out of the dryer. Yeah. Anyone else? Yes.
Sheets after they've been pulled off the line.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's part of my list. I'll share my list in a second, unless you folks take up the whole time. Yes.
Fresh
break baked bread, yeah.
The seashore when you get close.
The seashore, yeah, as you get close. You can smell it before you see it. And our last one, yes.
The rain.
The rain. The rain, yeah. Yes. So let me give you a little bit of my list. Some of you have already taken from it. Fresh break baked bread. Smells great. We once had someone in the church bring in their bread maker, and I gave them instructions about an hour before church, set it up in the sacristy right behind that door, and turn it on so that when people came in the church on a communion Sunday, they could smell fresh baked bread. Unfortunately, they didn't hear the part about set it up in the sacristy there. Instead, set it up in the lounge. No one smelled it but me. Coffee hour was very popular. Yeah. Morning rain. We heard that one. A newly cut Christmas tree. Beeswax candles, which we use when we do our love feast once a year. Clothes just out of the dryer, or better, just off the clothesline. You heard both of those. An ocean breeze. For me, a White Castle hamburger right out of the box. That new car smell, which costs about $10,000 more than the used car smell. By the way, they do have something they put on those cars that are used to make them smell like new car smell. And freshly tilled soil in a garden. Not that I till it, but when my people come over to till the little garden in front, it smells wonderful then. So, yes. But what do these smells tell us? Why do they give us such comfort? And notice, so many of us share the same great smells in our lives. But as we sit here today, they tell us important things. I don't know why exactly, but I think they tell us that we have enough. That we have enough. They tell us that we are blessed. They tell us that we are loved. But as we sit here in worship this morning, offering up our praise and our thanksgiving, I have to wonder this. What smells good to God? What smells good to God? Join me in a word of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So what does sacrifice smell like? You saw the scripture verse that Val read up on the screen. Is it the smell of mother's milk on the breath of a baby? Is it the smell of the stale aftershave a father puts on every morning before heading off to work to support his family? Is it the smell of incense burning on an altar? Or is it something else? What does sacrifice smell like? On the first Friday of Lent, John, who was a good Baptist, was outside grilling a big juicy steak on his grill. Meanwhile, all of his neighbors, good Catholics all, were sitting down to eat cold tuna fish for supper, which was their spiritual practice. This went on each Friday for a few weeks into Lent before finally the men had had enough. It's tough to eat cold tuna on Friday when you can smell steak in the air nearby. So finally the men got together, the neighbors, and they had to do something about John. He was just tempting them to eat meat each Friday of Lent, and they just couldn't take it anymore. So they decided to try and convert John to Catholicism, a good faith. They went over and they talked to him, and they were overjoyed when he agreed, well, to join all of his neighbors and become a good Catholic. Problem solved. They immediately took him to the local parish, and the priest put him up in the chancel and sprinkled some water over him and said these words: "You were born a Baptist, you were raised a Baptist, but now you are a Catholic." The men of the neighborhood were so relieved because now their biggest Lent temptation was resolved. But that very next Friday, at supper time, when the neighborhood was sitting down for their fish dinners, the sweet smell of steak cooking on a grill came wafting into their windows. The neighborhood men could not believe their noses. What was going on here? They called each other up and decided to meet over in John's yard to see if he had forgotten it was a Friday in Lent. Now, the group arrived just in time to see John standing next to his grill, dipping a barbecue brush with a small pitcher of water and sprinkling it over his steak with the grill, saying, "You were born a cow. You were raised a cow, but now you are a fish." Nothing smells better to me than a steak sizzling on a grill, I promise you that. I had the best steak of my life a number of years back and had it again just the other day. You can get it at the Steak Loft in Mystic, Connecticut. It was a teriyaki skirt steak to die for. It was tender. It was sweet. It was tangy all at the same time. My mouth was watering, and I'm breaking out into a cold sweat just thinking about it right now. Problem is that the steak that used to cost $17 pre-COVID now costs $30, and when you add the cost of gas having gone up, I just can't afford that luxury too often, which is maybe God's way of saying, cut back on the beef, buddy, but who knows? But it reminded me of something I was, well, preparing for this morning's message. It reminded me that in Jesus' day, burnt offerings were an acceptable form of worship. During the Passover season, good Jews, would show up at the temple to make a sacrifice for their sins. The thinking was that your sins would be placed into the animal that was sacrificed, and therefore, when the animal was sacrificed, your sins would be forgiven. That was an acceptable form of worship. And it was often said throughout Scripture that the smell of these offerings were pleasing to God. It's right there. That's right. God likes the smell of a good steak on the grill as much as I do. But is that what God requires of us? Is that what God requires of us? Is that the sacrifice that God wants from us? In our gospel lesson this morning, Mary has done it again. You remember Mary. Mary is one of the sisters of Lazarus. She and Martha live in Bethany, just a stone's throw along the road to Jerusalem, and Jesus would often stop and stay with them on his way on those occasions when he went to Jerusalem. Most of you remember how she left her sister Martha to do all the cleaning up after serving the disciples so that she could sit at the feet of Jesus and listen to him teach. Martha was unhappy then. Judas is unhappy now. Why? Well, you see, Mary has done it again, this time something worse than leaving dirty dishes in the sink. This time, Mary has taken a jar of very expensive perfume, spikenard, as it was known, and she broke it over Jesus' feet. This wasn't like one of your young children taking your best bottle of perfume or cologne and pouring it out over the family pet in preparation for a pretend tea party. No, this was much more serious. A jar of spikenard was worth about 300 denarii at the time, which was a common laborer's yearly salary. They made a denarii a day for very hard work. 300 denarii were close to a year's salary. So Mary's act of worship was worth a full year of hard labor. Now, let's put this into perspective for you. Imagine your child washing the family pet with your 401k. You'd freak out a little bit. Judas was livid by all accounts. How could anyone be so irresponsible? In fact, the jar that the spikenard was put in was sealed. And the only way to open it was to break the jar. That was the way of showing how valuable it was. You really had to have a good reason for using it. And in fact, it was only really used to anoint a body after death. How could anyone waste so much on a single act of love when there were so many hungry mouths to feed, so many of the poor to be cared for? We can understand the economic and charitable logic behind Judas's criticism. But we should also recognize that it resembles a rigid, unyielding piety that cannot stomach a wild and reckless love like Mary's. She stepped out of the norms and used something expensive for people who were expendable. Acts of true grace and love regularly get slandered as deviance. It was true then, and it is true now. That's why I'm so proud that our denomination is known for and lays claim to an extravagant love. That we try to extend the bounds of love and who should be loved and who is lovable as wide as we can. It's why we became the first major denomination to approve same-gender marriage. And let me tell you, we took a lot of heat for that some years back when we did it. I was there that day at our General Synod in Atlanta when that vote was taken, and it was overwhelming. But I remember coming into the conference center in Atlanta, and there stood outside the entrance about 30 members of the Westboro Baptist Church holding up signs that were so vile, I wouldn't even want to say to you what they printed on them. And as I walked through that crowd yelling at me and the rest of us going in, I remember smiling and saying, well, this means we are doing the right thing today. And so we did. And to make matters worse on that day, Mary does something scandalous on top of it all. She lets down her hair and uses it to wipe Jesus' feet after pouring the nard on them. It was an intimate act of love that foretold of Jesus' death. How does Mary know this is coming? Anyone who knew Jesus well enough knew where he was angling, knew how dangerous it was for him to say what he was saying, knew what the ultimate cost could be unless he put his feet on the brakes and stopped from going too far. But we have hindsight. We can look back and know what he chose to do, but more importantly, what the end result was. Mary simply did not count the cost, the financial cost of using the nard. She never seemed to count the cost. When Mary was with Jesus, she lost all sense of proportion and propriety. And Jesus loved her for it. Loved her for it. Jesus always ruled in favor of Mary and her wildly extravagant love. A sacrifice acceptable to God, which the Bible calls true worship. That's what you saw from the book of Micah, one of the great prophets of the Old Testament. A sacrifice acceptable to God is not a good steak on a grill or even a hefty donation. Or even being in church every single Sunday. Because you've heard me say this. You're no more a Christian by coming to church every week than you are a chicken McNugget by going to McDonald's. That's not the determining factor of either. A donation, attendance on a regular basis are both acceptable to God, but neither are what God requires of us. There's the key word, requires of us. What does God require of you? What is acceptable worship? And it's a great question to ask for Lent, as we're asked to not only look deeply at who we are and what within us may be broken, or helps to break others? What does God require of us as human beings in a world filled with human beings? And here is what Micah says. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with a burnt offering, with a calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with my thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgressions? Well, depending on how your firstborn is acting out when they reach their teenage years, that's a consideration. The fruit of my body for the sins of my soul? No. No, says Micah, he has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? Remember these words. To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. The hardest lesson of life is learning that it is not all about you or me. In fact, our greatest quest is to live a life that is continually less about me and more about others. More about how Jesus lived, sacrificially. Sacrificially. The Apostle Paul writes these words in his letter to the Ephesians: "Walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." Can you hear how the Apostle Paul is saying that sacrificial love is a fragrant offering to God? You often hear the phrase by devout Christians. They always worry me. It's the devout part, not the Christian part. That Jesus died for our sins. Particularly popular during Lent. It's how the church mostly marketed the Christian faith for the past 2,000 years. Jesus died for your sins. And yes, it's said to trigger guilt. If you weren't such a sinner, Jesus wouldn't have had to die. But that's only one version of what we call the theology, the doctrine of atonement, making right between us, a fragile, broken people, and God, who is the essence of love. Jesus died on a cross. We know this. It's not a fairy tale. It's historically entered into the Roman historical document. They kept track of who they crucified. Jesus died on a cross, though, but not to pay a debt to some cosmic evil that would otherwise claim and punish us. Jesus died on a cross to show that what true love really looks like. Wouldn't you die for the persons you love the most? Jesus died on a cross to show us what love truly looks like in action. In action. That's what cost Jesus his life, his willingness to die for the cause of love and justice, not his concern over what would happen to himself or to all of any of us after we passed from this life back into God's care. Jesus is not some cosmic bellhop who carries your luggage for you, or the garbage man who takes out your trash once a week, in our case, once a month. Jesus is the one who shows you what love in action looks like. What smells good to God? Loving your neighbors. Loving your enemies. Feeding the hungry, housing the homeless, visiting the sick. What smells good to God? Your humility, your willingness to put the last first and be the first who goes to the back of the line for others. What smells good to God? Besides White Castle hamburgers, because I'm pretty sure God loves those as well, our willingness to be servants, to welcome the stranger, to tear down walls and to build bridges instead. So we know what smells good to you. Take the rest of Lent to consider. What smells good to God, and whether you have that scent all over you. Amen. Bruce, why don't you introduce your duet partner today?
Do I have to?
Yeah.
Yeah, folks, good morning. My special guest today is Teresa Hooker, and she's an awesome vocalist and flautist, and today she's going to be doing a flute, and she's going to be doing most of the hard work today, so hope you enjoy it. Oh, and there's the New London Philharmonic Orchestra is here, too.
Thank you.
Thank you both for that beautiful piece. Edie Dole's going to come up now and play Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star for you. One-handed. Now there's something impressive. Val, you're up.
Please join me in prayer. Loving God, powerful Father and comforting Mother, we thank you for all of the blessings we have received today in this worship service. Love of our friends and visitors, the music, the stories, the metaphors that cause us to open our minds to new thought, to new ways of being. God, many of us come here today with burdens of those that we love, those whom are on our hearts, that we may be concerned about and worried about. And before we go further into our prayer, dear Lord, we ask that you would take these names and cleanse our hearts, even if it's just for a little while. God, hear the names of those that we offer up to you at this time. God, we know that you know the burdens of our heart, and we offer the names not to remind you, but to release us. In giving you our problems and troubles, they seem to get smaller. And for that, we are grateful. God, we thank you for everything that you have given us, everything that you have taken away, and everything that you have left. We thank you for the beauty of this day and the signs of spring, even if it comes in the form of cold rain, we will take in the sense of that and be grateful because all of it is important for our earth to flourish and for us to experience spring and summer. Lord, we hold up to you those who keep us safe in our communities, those who administer medical care, those who keep our lines of communication open. We pray for those who stand on very unsettled ground in the Ukraine, in the Middle East, in all places where there is conflict beyond many of our imaginations. We pray that we will not forget. God, there are certainly times in our own lives where things are just too heavy for us and words do not come to us. Help us to remember not only those suffering around the world, but those who suffer that we don't know about, those whose names were not offered up because we do not know the pain that they are carrying. But you do, Lord. You know what they need. You know what all of us need. We thank you for the intricate parts of our body that work so well. Everything that you have created, we are so fearfully and wonderfully made. We thank you for our imaginations where we can almost smell the things that we have talked about today. But help us to remember, as Pastor Bob told us, that it is love that is the scent that is most pleasing to you. And you gave us the greatest example of that love when you gave us your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And what joys and blessings do we have today?
Joshua will be graduating this June, and he has already accepted a job at Electric Boat that he will start right after he graduates.
Was unable to attend the soup supper this past Wednesday night for a pretty good reason. Susan and I celebrated our 54th wedding anniversary on Wednesday.
Pastor Bob had alluded to this before, but my joy today is when communion was being served, I was like, this is like old home day. The choir's here, the deacons are serving, Bruce is back. So it's just a very wonderful feeling today, and I'm glad we were able to make it.
My joy is not that I broke my collarbone, but that I had two of the best caregivers this week, my daughter and son-in-law.
And another joy is we'll be back in here for Easter singing the Hallelujah Chorus. And just a little announcement, after service today, right after, we're going to rehearse it. So anybody who wants to join us on Easter, it'd be good if you sat in.
So my joy is for our young people. I work at Connecticut Children's, and there's a dance-a-thon at UConn where the kids raise money all year long. Hundreds of kids do this, students. And last night, it culminated at midnight. That's why my voice is raspy and I'm a little tired this morning. With the big reveal of how much money they raised. And they danced for 24 hours, and this is the culmination of all that. And they raised $1.3 million this year. And that amount goes up every year. It's just incredible dedication, and it's so solemn, and the ceremony is wonderful and inspirational. But it says a lot about our kids.
Well, if there are no further joys, we don't collect money here with a basket by being passed throughout the sanctuary, but we do have boxes at each of the entrance exits. If you are so inclined to make a donation or to do so online, this church does wonderful, wonderful work. But we do sing praises to God for all of our blessings, many of which we have heard today. So please rise and join me in singing our doxology.
Let's join together now in the singing of our closing hymn. It's number 286 in your hymnals, and let's do the first two verses. We don't want to run too long. Okay?
Spirit.
You may be seated. Please join me in saying our commissioning, which is printed in your bulletins. We have worshiped God together. Now we go our separate ways. May the Spirit that blessed us here be the Spirit that blesses us each day. Amen.